All right, this is Beyond the Beach podcast. I'm Jack and I'm joined by Nathan as always. We're here at beautiful Sunday morning down at Omanu Surf Club. And with that, we're pleased to let you all know that we've got Scott Bartlett on the podcast for today, doing a bit of breaking down of our 24 athletes that have been selected for the junior and senior Blackfins to compete at Worlds. So Scotty, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you very much.
Obviously, very well-established coach through clubs and New Zealand teams as well in the past, and currently a selector. So tell us a bit about the selection process, I guess, that you go through to pick the right athletes.
Thank you. Thank you guys for having me. I guess being my background is arrived into New Zealand back in 2004 and then picked up one of the selectors roles at the back end of 2005, and that saw me taking all the way through to 2016, so about just on 11 seasons as selector initially. During that time, I was assistant coach in 2006 and 2008 campaigns, and then moved into the head coaching role in 2009 through to the end of 2014. Had a couple of years break and then came back into the selector's role. So I'm currently in my 15th season as a New Zealand selector. It's a tough role. It really is hard. You are selecting teams based on allocations given through to Surf Life Saving New Zealand from High Performance Sport New Zealand. So this year, you'll see High Performance Sport's really starting to tighten up on sports here in New Zealand about how many people can be carried in the different portions of the performance program. You've got to select using a wider net that makes sense and looking to what you've got coming up 12 months, 18 months and 24 months down the line. But you're also going to select what is the most important carnival within the performance year. So what that is this season will be obviously Worlds, which is starting in 3 months' time, back end of August. So the last selection, which happened only about 4 weeks ago, was for the two teams attending World Championships this year. So it was hard. It was really hard, and it's never easy. People miss out. That's unfortunate, but it comes down to trying to select what is the best fit of athlete to work in along with the strategy that the head coach and Surf Life Saving New Zealand has put forward.
Yeah, cool. And I guess, like, touching on Worlds, here in New Zealand, like, and I know I've been in the junior team in the past, like, we don't often get a good gauge of how points work. It's not just gold, silver, bronze. It's not our typical 3-2-1, 5-3-1 we do here in New Zealand. So I guess talking about format of Worlds, both inter-club and national teams, what
kind of the point system and how does that work?
Yeah, it's a good call, because there are people in the program who don't really understand or get it. So to give you a really good analogy on how it works is that if you win the Ironman on the beach, it's the same amount of points as if you were to win the line throw in the pool. 20 points to win, 20 points. So it's the same sort of breakdown. There are first, second, third. So the top eight are awarded points from 20 all the way down to 10. So 20, 18, 16, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10. Then you miss number 9. And then from 9 through to 16 goes 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Now, to win the World Championships, you've got 42 events over 5 days. And you're allowed 12 athletes, 6 male, 6 female. So you've got to try and plug 12 athletes over 42 events, and you've also got to have 2 athletes per event as well, except for relays, obviously. But individual races, there are 2 per event. And that's where depth of athlete across multiple events does come into play. Unfortunately, the way Worlds works in its current format, it's very difficult to take a pure specialist of any single discipline. You need to have a few feathers in your bow to be able to participate well at a World Championships.
And as a selector too, are you involved in selecting the coaches for the campaigns?
No. The coaches, they go through a normal process of submitting applications that goes through the High Performance Sport New Zealand. They'll have a panel that'll sit down and work out who's the best suited for interviews, and they just go through an interview process. So it's no different than a job interview. You submit applications and you go through a pretty strict process.
Yeah, cool. And I guess, like, we're looking at the Gold Coast for the venue, Gold Coast Aquatic Centre and Karawa Beach. What can we really expect with it being at Karawa? I know there's a bit of a backup plan
with North Kura.
Yep, correct. So if you've done Aussies the last 10 years, then you'll understand that Kura can be exposed to the elements there. So North Kura, right down the airport part of the coast, has always been the backup. you can run 6-7 arenas down there and not really be affected by swell. I say not really affected. It still takes a bit, but it's not as bad as Caro is. Caro is a great beach. I mean, you can get that, like, that small amount of water, that big long trough, the big long sandbank that it drops off again. So it's a great beach. Sprints and flag wise, it's amazing, but it'll depend on what they can fit in. Whether there's been any storms that's come through in the previous 2 or 3 weeks prior to that, because that can wash away beach. So it's probably the one place in the world where there are multiple venues where they can have a backup carnival.
Yeah, and I suppose it's pretty amazing that it's like the Mecca of surf life surfing globally.
Yeah.
We have, you know, I can't even remember there ever being a Worlds on the Gold Coast. Adelaide's one that's been.
Yeah, Adelaide's had toes. 2000 was in Manly, 4 Italy, 6 was Geelong and Melbourne, 8 Germany, 10 Egypt, 12 Adelaide, 14 France, 16 Netherlands, 18 Adelaide, and then 21 was.
Shiani.
Yeah,
Shiani.
So,
in terms of organization, it's so cool for us, like the European countries, to be able to, they watch Aussies probably every year and all that, and they're coming to the Gold Coast, probably, you know, different things to expect. I guess it's really cool. And from an organization standpoint, it's Surf Life Saving Queensland that have taken that, and they're pumping out the all the organization for that. So it'll be interesting to see how that works.
Yeah.
Whether it's big sprints and stuff.
Yeah, yes. Yeah. So the national competition is always where you're trying to work out who's the best country in the world. Then you have the Club Worlds, which is where it's open to any registered surf life saving club in the world. That this year will be super competitive, because you're basically taking every person who can get a ticket from around Australia up to the Eastern Seaboard. So they'll be very, very strong, I'd imagine. I better be stronger than sort of nationals, Aussie nationals it would be.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing, especially for those Aussies. And not, you know, having, like you said, France, Netherlands, you still get your clubs like Northbrook that have the numbers and the backing to send a team, but now it's kind of like everyone's going to be.
Well, I think we probably guess that Northcote could send 3 or 4 powerful teams, not just the one. They could do 3 or 4. And I guess there'd be half a dozen clubs up in Queensland that could do that as well.
And within the club, it's a bit different, isn't it? It's not 6 boys, 6 girls.
Yeah, I think it's a bit more open.
I think 10 boys, 10 girls. So clubs like the Mount, Omanu, Morangi Bay, Red Beach have, like, you know, there's a good opportunity to jump the ditch.
Yes, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Cool. So I guess we're going to pick some bark off the teams and break down who will be doing what, why they're in the team, workloads. So starting with the juniors, Nate, who do you think stands out, with who might have the biggest workload?
Oh, I feel like Daniel Calibur and Hiani, you know, they're those guys that can do everything, like in the pool and on the beach.
Yeah.
So I guess,
how do you see them fitting in?
I think you'll find Hiani, to start with, he'll have a couple of the shorter events in the pool. So I wouldn't be surprised if he has the 50 carry and he'll be a relay swimmer. And then you'll see him get pretty worked hard on the beach around individual races and the team races. So he'll be busy. Daniel, again, could pick up a couple of those 100s and maybe a 200 super or 200 odds relay swimmers as well. And don't forget, there's a cert competition there as well. So can it? No. So it is on the program. However, they have chopped it before. So we'll see how that pans out. But he'll be pretty busy, I would imagine.
Yeah, I can see him with it starting on the beach for the youth as well. Makes it a little bit different. We always go to the pool feeling so fresh, and that tape is so important. Yeah. We hit times and stuff. But yeah, in the past, you know, going from beach to the pool, you can't really let that get into your head.
It's a bit harder, because you're right. I mean, the national teams are fresh tape into the pool, you know, based like a normal swimming program would be. But yeah, it's a bit harder for the youth.
And someone like Daniel, who no doubt will be doing the Ironman.
Probably board race, surf race. Yep.
A lot of those relays. And then, like, I see him doing 200 odds and super, like, that's a pretty heavy program. Yeah. And then on the girls' side, Tara Schotter probably be doing a very good program.
I think the thing to consider between beach and pool is that on the beach, New Zealand, Australia, and some of the South African athletes as well can use the qualifying rounds as I'll tread carefully here. You can use it as almost a warm-up, because it's not as hard for them to qualify through. It's completely the opposite in the pool. You cannot do that. You've got to race PBs in the morning, and it's always been times in the morning, medals at night. So you get the fast times in the morning, qualify through to the A final, and then worry about medals at night. So it's completely the opposite.
And that's a really good point too. Like, you could, like you say, be off your PB, still make the B final, and do a time in your B final that's going to get your third overall, but that's only, like you said, the max points, babe.
Correct, yeah. So if you're in the B final, you only will get B final points. You don't get A final points. Even if you, and I saw at last Worlds, we had a couple of athletes who would have ranked themselves third and fourth, but didn't qualify for the A final, got it through the B final. So,
yeah. I do think, like, if any of those junior black fins are listening, it's really important to understand that.
Yeah.
I know that then the team that we had, we weren't really accustomed to how those points work. And, you know, getting a DQ and a B final just 0 points, is that?
Yeah, it's brutal. Yeah. So my advice would be you've got to get up and race as quick and as fast as you physically can in the morning.
And we never really do heats and finals. Rescue, don't we?
No, it's time finals in New Zealand, just because of the way it's still a developing discipline.
Yeah, and sure. You talk about, like, athletes could be doing this. Are you involved in the selection process now for events, or is that?
No, the event breakdown, what will happen is you have the two league coaches, so you have the youth league coach and we have the senior coach, and they, once their athletes are selected, they have pitched already to the selectors what they believe is the best format for those individual athletes. So we have the option to sit down and select and say, right, well, Daniel Calibert, is he the best fit for these events? Zach would have submitted that to us, and we have a look at that. We can question and query that as well. Then we go to it, and then upon review, so after the last ones, we've had a look down and break down. We looked at what I thought was the best athlete per event, and then it doesn't always work out, and that's the beauty of hindsight. You can pick it apart post an event, but pre, you do it based on the data available and communication of what you sat down and spoken to that athlete as well, what they're capable of. There's 3 or 4 months preparation that's got to go into a pool event to make sure you're up to speed. You got to race it consistently and over, particularly the events that are high spec technical, super lifesaver, rescue medley, 100 carry, 100 tube with fins, they're all technical events.
Yeah, and I guess someone like Lane Crichton, who's won the Golden Foot for the ski, like, that just goes to show the consistency on the ski. And a lot of people might be like, oh, well, that's a special ski paddler. But one of the strengths, I think, in this junior team this year is our male Beachy, Zach, female Beachy, Mickey, Pocock, and Lane are all pretty, like, you know, diverse. We don't have a really, like, specific Beachy. So, Mickey's ski paddler, Lane.
That's going to be that backup sprinter, no doubt.
Yep. Zach can do a board race if need be. Personally, I don't think he will. I think the strength with Yanni and Daniel will be there.
But if need be, yeah, Zach.
You also had splitting load on the beach as well. So, Zach and those the coaches will look at that and look at how the load will actually work with some of those guys, whether Yanni's capable of doing every single discipline back to back. They probably will split it up. And you've got to throw a tube rescue in there as well. There'll be heats. And that's probably an event there's a little bit more depth in as well, because European clubs have got a slightly better idea on how that sort of stuff works. However, Karawa Surf will
water movement, like,
will bring those guys back into a little bit of hurt.
It's not just a run and jump, start swimming.
No, so traditionally you looked at, like, the last sort of 5 or 6 world championships have all been at beaches, which has been pretty flat, or notoriously still. Richie Oney was a notoriously still beach, so that's to bring everyone sort of into a fair environment. Karawa kind of breaks that mold a little bit.
Completely, yeah. And I guess, like, transitioning onto our open black fins, we saw there's seven of the 12 athletes that are going around for the second, third, fourth time, and we have 5 debutants.
Yep.
The 5 debutants is quite strange, because it's Joe Collins, Louis Clark. These are all people that have so much experience, but just the first time in the open black fin. So I think, this team this year, you look at where Fergus was for last Worlds, just been a late call up to now being our strongest. The strongest pool in the world, arguably.
Yep.
How do you kind of feel about
our open black fins this time?
They're good. There's a good team. They are strong, and they've got each athlete's got 2 or 3 weapons, and that's key. That's really important. You talked about Fergus before. I think he's going to have a blinder this world. I really do. I think he's strong. He's pushing regular top 1 and 2 times every time he gets in the water. The 5 debutants, Joe's a fairly well-seasoned athlete now, so I don't see him having any problems. Oscar Smith will do well. He's great. He's got a really good level head on him. Who are the other ones? Zoe Crawford has been training the house down. I feel she is a great racer.
Yeah.
Very, very good racer. Yeah. She has a unique ability to stand up in the blocks and deliver, so she's very good. She's a bit of an X factor.
Right.
Yep. Raekwon's great too, so she's got the same sort of profile. She can stand up the block and deliver when it's needed, so she's, I'd watch her as well.
Yeah, and that sort of leadership, do you think like the boys like Chris and CT bring to that team?
Yeah, well, they've been around 10 years now, so Chris has been around since the 14 campaign, as has Corey, so they bring in that kind of era of when we won, and then they transitioned through to 16 and won again, so they've got that back-to-back experience. There's probably not too many people in the world right now that have got what they have.
Yeah, like that Australian team is always chopping and changing, and I see that they have a bit of a tier list, and then the people that say yes or no.
Yeah, look, I don't know how the politics plays over there, but yeah, I know it's a bit tricky, and they'll put their best foot forward. I know they take the national side of things very seriously, and it was when they lost it back in 2012, it was a big deal for them. So they threw everything at us in 2014, did work, but they'll come, and they'll just keep coming, and they're strong.
Yeah, and one thing in that team, we've obviously, there's two athletes that were in Junior Blackfins last time round that have now made steps to opens, and Oscar and Zoe.
Yep.
We had Ray, who was only pathway athlete last year, Trans-Tasman, to make open, so it's really good, that progression.
Yeah.
A lot of people that are close that have kind of just transitioned into opens, likes of no doubt Pippa and Jaden.
It's hard, like don't get me wrong, to make the national, you're talking about making the national team to compete on the world stage, it's not going to be given to you, and those guys are and girls that are in that team, and Kev Morrison always said to me, he said, I will stay in that team for as long as I physically can until someone takes it off me. And I think it's a great analogy to use, that I will be in this national team until the next person comes along and says, right, that's my spot now. And that's a good way of looking at it.
One thing that Steve Kent said to, I've heard him say it many times, like, make it so they can't not pick you.
Yeah.
Like, you just be so good at a few, like, that many things that they just can't.
And be consistent too. That's the other key, is that we get people coming up, well, I won the surf race at ERC, so am I a shot to make the team? No. And so, well, what have you got behind you? And what have you done? Is there consistency over a period of time? Not really. Okay, so you need to show that you've got wheels over a period of time.
And that's, like, even more important with Worlds Painting of August. Like, how do we know that you can carry
form through and really be able to peak in the rock?
There's so many variables. I mean, people just see, you know, sometimes the black and white of results, but there is just a huge hunk of variables that you need to look at and break apart and actually try and mold people into that team. It's not easy.
You talk about breaking it down and all of that. So how often are you, like, meeting with the selectors or having a discussion?
Oh, well, it's quite a bit. So as we get through winter, not so much unless we've got teams to select. We need to talk about stuff, but in season we'll have a conference call every 2 or 3 weeks where we discuss, we have spreadsheets, we discuss athletes, we know what's going where. Leading up to the first selection carnival, ERCs, we'll have 2 or 3 phone calls where we start putting people into columns and brackets, and we know where it's coming and hot spots we need to seriously look at. And then by the time we get to nationals, we've got a pretty good idea of what the requirements are to select that team, then we need to see people perform. Barring people who jump out of the blue and bolt and do amazing results that we haven't looked at, I like to think by the time we get to nationals, we've got a pretty good idea of how we're tracking and what we need to see.
Last 24 months, we've obviously seen a real big emphasis on developing our technical skills in the pool as a nation. And really, really, like, it's amazing that we could get the funding last year to get Kais River from Germany over, thanks to, like, Tanya Hamilton and the team up there. It made a huge difference. And I think one of the real like things I'm excited about for Worlds is our all relays.
Yeah.
Particularly the women's.
Yeah.
Like Maddie Kidd, Zoe Crawford, Molly Shibnan, and Raekwon. Like, it's going to be electric.
And that's probably the other thing to consider as well. In New Zealand, in relays, we have the 5-3-1 system here, first, second, and third. Doesn't matter at Worlds. It's still your standard points. So it's first, second, and third. So there's no extra points for relays. It's just your standard points breakdown.
So obviously with our open team, we've also got a new head coach. So with Steve Kent, what do you think he brings to the table as obviously being through as an athlete?
A wealth of experience. So I mean, going back to 2007, I first selected him to be part of our, what we call the International Pool Rescue Challenge, which was a competition between Australia and New Zealand in Homebush. So he came in as part of the development crew. So he's worked his way through, and he's got a huge chunk of experience. Yeah, a very good swimmer in his own right. So he understands and gets the whole technique around swimming. Also very good in the water. He has people around him to help him with the ski stuff and the board stuff, but understands it's been to Worlds, what, 6 or 7 different world championships. So there's not too many people in New Zealand who have done that. And so he gets and understands it. understands it, sorry. His ability to manage that has been really good. So him, he's worked quite closely with us over the last 6 months and developed a pretty good profile what he wants to see. So, and I think he's been communicating that quite strongly to athletes around the country. I think he's done a great job, and I think rewards will come.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. Like going straight from being an athlete to next world's being a coach, you know, he's still aware of where the threats are globally and competitors to watch out for.
Yeah.
I just think it's pretty good.
And
having Kev Morrison at his side,
yeah.
I just think energy wise, it's very they bring so much energy, and how could you not want to?
Yeah, well, Kev's been in that Northcliffe environment for what I'm thinking 15, 16 years now. So he has been around the cream of the crop of athletes, and from a management point of view with Wally, just learned from two or three of the best people around. So I feel like he's probably done an amazing apprenticeship, and he's now out on his own, carving his own destiny. I think Steve and Kev together, it's a pretty good combination.
Yeah, you touched on Wally, and then Kev would have picked up so much from him, and then guys like Shieldsy, and being a part of both of us, we see, you know, he just does so much outside of the coaching world to support his athletes, and arranging meetings. I know they start back training next week, and it's slow and it's steady, and there's all these things in place. He's always giving time to them. I guess moving on, kind of like as a selector, what do you think to date has been the hardest decision you've had to make? That you're allowed to share.
Look, every year there's tough stuff, and the hardest part is then sitting down with an athlete and explaining to them, you know, I'm sorry, but you haven't been selected for the team this time, but let's talk about why. That can get quite emotional. It is difficult. You've got to have that data. This year was pretty hard. It was really difficult because we had to make some crunch decisions, and it was hard. And talking to those people afterwards, because they are people that you're still on the program, but you've got to explain why. It's not easy. And then there's a lot of follow-up. There's Facebook stuff, there's social media stuff that can, people have cracks at you in that. But a lot of the time it's not understanding the entire picture, what happens all around as a selection whole. That's very hard. Probably the hardest part was actually having in my head the team set for 2012, and then receiving a phone call one day from Glenn Anderson saying that Ayla was pregnant and that him and Ayla were now out of the team. So when you have probably your number one male and your number one female swimmer go, what it did was it made me stop and think about, okay, how are we going to approach this? And it was actually Steve Kent that came to me and said, look, I've got an idea. How about we only take two male swimmers and then focus on the beach side of things? And it was like, so I went away, broke that down, looked at it from a spreadsheet perspective and what we could do there. And while the workload was massive for the two males, it actually was pretty good around what we could do on the beach. So something had never been done before. It worked well. It worked really, really well. And the results are history.
That's really interesting, actually. And I suppose another interesting sort of question a lot of people have is, if you don't make a team, who can you go to for clarity? And they're not coming to the selector, obviously. Yeah. There's a process they go through.
Yeah, definitely. So that's well communicated through Tanya Hamilton and the High Performance Sport information she sends out. So each week there's a newsletter that comes out. You would have received that as members yourself, and you can read that. There is a very strict process. So your first port of call, if you feel like you've missed out in selection, you go to Tanya. And you've got a 48-hour window post the announcement of the teams, and that's actually come through and put an application for review. Then you go down, she'll elevate you to like the process, and then you'll go through a strict kind of one-on-one with Tanya. Then you go through to meeting with the selector, and they'll explain the ins and outs as well. So I had two of those this year. And again, they were difficult.
Yeah.
Not easy. But
never.
No.
And I guess one thing that I'd like to ask is, what advice would you give, especially younger athletes that feel like they should be there?
Ask questions. Don't be afraid to go to the lead coach on the beach and say, look, I want to make this team. What am I going to do? Find a selector on the beach. Ask them. I think it's a no-brainer. Go and see someone. You want to make a team, go and ask. Go and ask the questions. Don't just kind of walk around the shadows thinking it's going to happen. Go make yourself heard. Go and ask the questions. And we get emails from time to time of people saying, hey, here's my training program. Here's what I'm doing. I'm tracking towards this goal. Just giving you a heads up. I love that. I think it's great. I mean, communication from athletes is really, really important.
I suppose it is difficult when they're getting a phone call. You know, they're just emotional. They haven't made a team. They just,
oh, yeah.
But it's right then and there, eh, where you just really
it's
have
hard.
To ask. And you guys are on the beach, in black shirts, most of the time. So,
yeah.
there to, you know.
I mean, most people know that the four selectors are. You've got Steve Ken, myself, Mitch Mitchell, and John Crichton. So you know those people. They're always on the beach. We always have four at the season nationals. So there's always a good representation of selectors on the beach. Go and talk to them.
Yeah, typical Kiwis, they sometimes can be a bit too humble and modest, for sure. Yep. Not want to put ourselves out there. And I guess it's just a reminder that
you really want to make the team. You got to fight for it.
Yeah, totally. Don't be afraid to ask and find out what you can do to make the next team or squad.
Yeah, 100%. And I want to kind of touch on your time as a New Zealand coach. And actually, we found a bit of an article. I think it was back in 2009. And it says Bartlett, who now lives in Mount Maunganui, has been assistant coach for the last 4 years. He takes the reign from John Spindles Bryant, who was stepped down after 6 years in charge.
Mm.
So that was way back in 2009.
Mm.
And I guess tell us about the success you've had as a Blackburns coach.
That first year was really tough because Corey came on as assistant coach that year as well. And our first two trips away, we had to go to World Games, which was in Taiwan. And the beach they put us in Taiwan had just been smashed by a typhoon. So when we got there for the first day on the beach, it was riddled with dead cats. And it was just it was the epitome of gross, you know. Then the second trip, Worlds, was in Egypt, which was single-handedly the hardest trip away I've ever had, because you're dealing with managing six girls who were placed into a large, and I'm not being rude, but a large Muslim environment, and they were ogled because girls on the beach, skinny togs, and that was really difficult.
Water?
Yep. Yeah, the water wasn't too bad, actually. It was okay, but the facilities where we were staying, we had to move hotels because they're exposed wires. It was just the epitome of a really, really hard trip. So Corey and I both found it very difficult. I look back on my time as coach and try and pinpoint what was our best team. And the 2012-2014 were amazing teams, but I always kind of lean towards the 2012 Worlds team just because of the sheer devastation they caused in the pool and on the beach. They were amazing people, and it was that kind of first major breakthrough post-1998 when Australia lost the title back then. We hadn't won it since then, so we won that in 2012. So I kind of sit towards the 2012 national team as being my favourite team.
Feels like that team had a lot of hunger too. Like, and you spoke about, was that the year you said Steve decided, like, is that when Glenn pulled out?
Yeah, so 2012 was when Glenn and Ayla pulled out to start a family. Glenn and Macca, and you know, if you go back into the research, Glenn and Macca did something like 18 and 20, Steve Ken and Andrew McMillan, something did like 18 or 20 races of pool racing in that high, intense environment. Like, that's in over 2 days. Incredible.
That's crazy.
Yeah, incredible. But then saying that, the girls, they won 4 of the 6 individual races. So yeah, Tarshine won the 50 and the 200 super in world record time. Then you had Sam Lee, who won the 100 rescue medley and the 200 odds. So 4 of the 6 individual races.
Yeah.
And then they won 2 of the 3 relays. So they just dominated the pool. That was devastating.
Definitely something I can almost see happening this year too.
I think, and I look to what they've got, and I think it's a very strong team, and I'm quite proud of the selections we got there. I think they'll do well.
Yeah, and I guess you used to talk about Egypt being all those travel obstacles and things to overcome, and I mean, we're just over the ditch in Australia. A lot of them are living there. Like, there's a lot of external factors that have just been eliminated.
Yep.
Nearly a home advantage to some extent.
Yep.
Yeah, very much so.
Yeah. And in that regard, would you, like, what are the options with having a Worlds in New Zealand in the future?
It's a good question, right? I think we could handle the national side of things. I wonder about the club Worlds, whether we're big enough or we've got the facilities up. I suspect we probably could, of just whether New Zealand have had the appetite to run it. It'd be amazing.
Yeah,
it'd be amazing.
Where do you see the beach program? Because obviously probably looking at AUT or something for the pool.
Yeah, so because you'd have to look at it. Probably two options now. You've either got Gisborne or you've got Auckland. I think Auckland would probably win over just the size and the combination of people and the fact that it is a the pool's up there. I think it's 2.5 meters, is it?
2.2.
So you need to be between 1.8 and 3 meters to be a world's rated pool. So world records can be set. I'd say Auckland would probably win over with maybe the surf side of things at the Mirawai like it was in 98. However, there's been last 2 or 3 worlds where there's been travel between pool and beach. So there's nothing to say they couldn't do the pool up at AUT and then come down here and do the beach.
Yeah, it's certainly
a little bit. 3 hours down the coast.
Totally. Pretty amazing. Yeah, I was kind of thinking maybe Takapuna just because that
world masters. Yep, and it's flat. That could be definitely an option. Yeah. So I think to answer your question, it would be pretty cool.
Mm. Yeah, 100%. And I guess, like, What's one absolute balls up story you've had as a coach?
Something like an experienced traveler. What?
Oh, I've had plenty of balls ups. I mean, I don't get me wrong, I made plenty of mistakes as when I was coaching, and I still make them today in my role here at Omanu. But I think the ability is to don't make the same mistake twice.
Yeah,
and that's what I try and learn from. However, I had made the same mistake twice, so I've got plenty of flaws, but I certainly bounce back and try and nut them out again.
What's the story from a campaign that kind of many people would know about?
I think the biggest time I got stung was World Games in 2009 when we got there and found out it was three per individual race, not two, and that sent us into a little bit of preparation. So we didn't know that beforehand, but we found out the hard way. So we then had to use the likes of John Gatfield for a 200 obs when he was a drop dead sprinter. So just little things like that. Probably not taking seriously enough just how sick you can get in Egypt. We lost two athletes who got real crook, Kev Morrison and Rachel Clark, both got from the water, both got pretty crook. And I think Kev Morrison was vomiting 2 or 3 days hardcore before his racing started. So that's pretty tough in a world's environment. We didn't probably treat that as seriously as we should have. I made selection mistakes as well. There's no doubt about that. But we've made some pretty good selection too.
Sure, there's been the highest with the success going 3 in a row. That's pretty amazing.
And obviously with a big focus on pool
athletes. Cool. I guess one thing with Worlds that a lot of athletes don't realise, especially their first time until they're in the middle of it, is the emotional roller coaster that comes with Worlds, the highs, the lows. Kind of how have your experience and
seen athletes go through it?
Yeah, I think the key for athletes is to have a support network around you, so people you can go to and talk it out. It's difficult because Worlds can be amazing, but it'll be pretty brutal as well. I watched my daughter go to Worlds and she had up and then down, up and then down. It is a roller coaster, but if you can have 2 or 3 people that you can spitball and talk to them outside of your events, I think that's a key. You've got to have that ability to say, what went wrong? What could I do better? All right, now I need to close that one off and move on to the next one. So it's a key to have those people to talk to.
So important to touch base with those people outside because, as a coach for Zach and yourself back in the day and Steve, they've got to deal with 12 different personalities and 12 different athletes and that, have different things they deal with, different ways they deal with disappointment and success. And
absolutely.
Yeah, it's definitely got to cater. Like you said, the support network, because you can't do everything.
No, so it'll be, you'll have a parent who'll be quite honest with you around some stuff, and there could be your mate, you might go to Lockie, you might go to Jaden and say, look, what did you think? And they'll say, well, actually, let me tell you what I think. And that's, never be ashamed to be told that you've made mistakes or done something wrong. People can fly off the handle, but you've got to have the ability to say, that was right. I can move around and do that a little bit better. So you as an athlete, you've got to be prepared to hear hard stuff at times. And I think if you're prepared to ask the question, you've got to be prepared to hear the answer.
Yeah, there's definitely a level of maturity you need to meet leading into Worlds. And then, if you're not met it, then after Worlds, you're certainly aware of where that is. And I guess, for myself personally at Worlds, we had Mike Ellis as the physio, and he has been since Youth Worlds became a thing back in 2012. And I know every single one of us 12 athletes, could feel like he was, someone to talk to at night on the table, whether we're getting a little massage or whatever, and he's physio / psychologist, I say.
Mike's pretty good in that space.
Yeah.
He's really good.
Yeah, he's epic, and he's obviously back on board again this year. So, any youth athletes would definitely make the most of that.
Yeah.
And like you said, having that support network too.
And we've got a lot of our, athletes this year looking at it from small regional clubs in New Zealand. So what do you say to them who might be, grinding away by themselves over winter?
I think you've got to try and reach out to some of your teammates and say, hey, do you want to do a joint session together? So that may mean you change your week around a little bit. So, instead of the old traditional Monday through to Saturday afternoon, it may look like Tuesday to Sunday. You just got to be a little bit smarter and program a little bit more to actually make it a bit more interesting. It's way easier to meet 2 or 3 people at say, Omanu or Mount Maunganui and go for a paddle together than if you do a proper set together, push each other. But you just need to think about it and change your program around a bit.
It keeps it fresh over winter too.
Winter training's tough. It is hard. Board and ski paddle is very hard, particularly board. It's probably harder than anything at all. So you've got to try and find those little hurdles to make it easier for you if you can.
And doing board over winter might not be something you've ever done in the past,
Yeah, so you don't see too many people doing board paddling in the winter here in New Zealand. You might see the odd person down at Pilot Bay, but still it's pretty tough on the arms.
Sure, and I guess we don't take our podcast to the namesake, Beyond the Beach. So who is Scott Bartlett Beyond the Beach, and what's your earliest memory of the sport? How did you get into it?
So I grew up in the Northern Beaches in Sydney. So my earliest memories was learning to swim in the DY rock pool on the beach. So I would have been 3 or 4 that time at that stage of my life. It's pretty tough learning lessons in a rock pool. That progressed through to doing Nippers and Manly, and then I was with Manly my entire life in Sydney. So fortunate enough to go through the Nippers program, then transition to seniors, and then grew up in a period of the 90s with Manly, which was very, very strong. So they were the premier club in Australia. It was a great time, the likes of Riddo and Guy Leach, swimming against those guys. And a lot of those Uncle Toby's fellas used to come and train at Manly, so we used to always bump around. You know, Grant Kinney, Sean Kinney, Robbo, there was a lot of good heads there. So it was pretty fortunate, it was a good space. But my world was swimming, so I was in the Carlisle Swimming Organisation. So we were swimmers first and foremost, and then surf life saving second, and that was always the way it was for me. Recreation-wise, diving and fishing is my big thing. So I just spent 7 days down in Fiordland again. That's probably my favourite place in New Zealand to go and wind out. There's no cell phone reception, so you can't be touched. It's a great spot, and it's certainly probably my main pastime.
Certainly, and so important to have those things to decompress out, even get a bit of solitude. And, you know, it's such tense times, like leading internationals as an athlete.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, the bit on the plate.
You mentioned the likes of Riddo, Craig Reddington, and Guy Leach, who were superstars back in, obviously, when you were growing up, and real pioneers of the sport as well. So I guess both in the sport of swimming and surf lifesaving and outside, who a couple, like a few of your role models, who have you kind of taken a lot of things from?
The biggest role model I had in swimming was Kieran Perkins. He was a phenomenal athlete, so I was fortunate enough to be in a couple of his world record races, the 800 and the 15 and the 4, so 3. I just thought he was a superstar. He changed swimming in Australia from the way he raced and the fact he used to go out in a 1500 in a 53.5 first, you know. No race suit, togs, you know, that was incredible. He was amazing. Susie O'Neill was a butterfly in Sydney, so she was incredible too. I used to rate her. But the likes of, there was a guy from Western Australia called Dean Peters. He was a surf race swimmer. So back in 91, I think he won 4 gold medals in the open arena. He was an amazing swimmer. Rated him. Riddo, I caught up with Riddo a couple of weeks ago. I had a couple of beers with him. He was good value. But I was, you know, living in Sydney, you're surrounded by top athletes. So I was very fortunate to grow up in an environment where swimming was massive and surf life saving was massive. So I was hovering around some really cool people.
And obviously living here in the Mount now in New Zealand, in 2004 you said you moved over. So how did you settle here? And
so went from Sydney to New Plymouth. I was married at the time and we ended up in New Plymouth because that's where Jackie's family was. That was a bit of a culture shock coming from Sydney to New Plymouth. It took a while to get used to how that kind of lifestyle. Fortunately for me, the diving and surfing in New Plymouth is phenomenal, so that kind of helped a little bit. But then in 2007, I got a role with the Old Sport Bay of Plenty here, coaching coaches, so I came into that. Lasted that for 12 months and then picked up a coaching role here at the surf club and then did that for 3 and a bit seasons and then created the swim school program that we did before building the big facility, and we did that for 13 years. Sold that last year, went traveling for 6 months and then started as the general manager here at Omanu.
How have you kind of seen like the progression since 2004 with surf lifesaving in New Zealand? Like, where do you think it's at, and do you think it's thriving, or where was, I guess, the peak? If it's not now, when was it?
It's a good question. The pool program from 2004 has just gone up. I think we've plateaued a little bit in the mid-teens. I think we need to come back up again, and I think some of the programs Steve's doing now will see a resurgence in that. Some of the events that are changing in the ILS now will see some different style athletes come into play. On the beach, I thought the peak of surf lifesaving was when Surf League was around. I thought that was an amazing competition and regionally very, very cool. But it wasn't just the breeding of athletes, it was also the breeding of managers, coaches, assistant coaches. I think that was a really good format for all that kind of breeding. I thought Nationals this year was pretty good. I thought Oceans this year was pretty good. I think there's some pretty good people running the different carnivals now, so there's some good eggs in the sport mechanism here in New Zealand. I think the one thing to look at going forward is waves versus live heats, that program. I know I have a preferred model, but that's something that the Surf NZ will have to work out. I think once they nut that out, and they get a really good model, and the time on the beach will be less, and I think you'll see a more flowing carnival.
And obviously you've had kids coming through the sport, so how do you manage being dad and a selector?
Not well sometimes. Lucy and Monique probably caught the brunt of stuff around selections. I know Lucy gets questions all the time. I actually got a whole bunch of questions this year around why some people weren't selected, and that's hard on them. But just explaining to them that's not the way it's supposed to be. She's just got to not think about that one. Lessons I learned with the older two girls certainly bodes well for my 12-year-old who's in the Oceans program now. So they're quite different for me. I'm working different angles with him. He gets to go surfing and enjoy it probably a whole lot more. He hasn't got intense dad in his corner, which probably the two older girls had a little bit more of. So I'm probably got a little bit more mellow as I got a bit older with my kids too.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, and I guess like one of the biggest, like I guess, movements in our sport the last 5 months is Corey Hutton has come into Omanu, and you know, we touched on the article back in 2009 when you picked him as your assistant coach, and I guess how does it feel to kind of come full circle and have him in a club setting now?
It's great. So we've kind of flipped roles. He's the lead coach, and I'm there in the support mechanism. He's doing great. He leads the sport program here at Omanu. I pick up all the paperwork around him because Corey and laptops are not kind of a match made in heaven. So yeah, so I do a lot of stuff with him there. I really enjoy what I'm doing with him. I love the fact that he's just focus on coaching alone. I think that's his real strength. He's doing a great job. The kids love him here. I think, you know, Oman is in pretty good shape at the moment.
And when did your relationship with him start? Because you obviously, were you a Manly?
Yeah, so he came out from Gisborne to Manly, I'm thinking, 93 or 94. So he was with Manly for a couple of years, and he was with Colorado first or Manly? One of the two. Colorado then Manly. So I've known Corey since the 90s, and we've had some on periods of time over the last 30-something years where we worked quite closely with each other.
What do you think the biggest thing he brings as a coach?
Oh, wealth of experience. He's very settled and calm in his approach and demeanor talking to athletes as well. So there's been some fires on the beach during nationals, which I've seen him put out beautifully and very well. I couldn't have done a better job. He does very, very well in that space. Got a very calm nature about it, as you guys probably know. I think the information he delivers is bang on, and very. I think he's probably the best board coach in the country, if not Ironman coach as well.
And obviously, talking about your role at Omanu, what can we expect from Scott Bartlett in the future?
I want to keep the role for 5 years. So I want to make sure that we have a really top sport and lifeguard program. So that's my focus, and to make sure that I continue working with the board to create a sustainable funding model. That's important as well, because the club's done very, very well financially over the last decade through investing wisely. So I want to make sure that I'm part of that continuing going forward as well.
And I guess one last question that I have to ask, and you've been to World Games, you've been to World Champs, International Rescue Challenge, everything, and there's no doubt there's a lot of conversation going on about getting surf into the Olympics for Brisbane 2032. I guess what are your thoughts around that? How do you think it looks like? And
I'm excited. It's going to be a potential sport. I think, you know, it's probably the pinnacle of our sport now, right? So I'm in the pool on the beach. There's a whole bunch of new events ILS wants to introduce into both programs to make them more spectator friendly. So it'd be interesting to see how that plays out. I guess the devil will be in the details of what exactly the program will look like going into Brisbane in 2032. So, for hand on heart, it's amazing. I just want to see some detail about what that looks like. But I think it's incredible for the sport. Gold medals.
Yeah.
Olympic gold medals.
Yeah, exciting times for our younger ones and our press.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, it's very cool. It's very cool.
Yeah, and I guess on that note, just like to thank you for coming on. Some real valuable insights for everyone listening, and no doubt we got something from them. Definitely know Scott Bart a little bit better from it. So, cheers.
Where would you rather spend a Sunday?
Yeah.
Sunday, yeah. The old skiff club of Manly is always pretty good for a Sunday afternoon, but yeah, Omanu here is pretty good. As you can see, it's lovely.
Yeah, always is. Sweet, awesome. Cheers, Scott.
Thank you.
Yeah.